Good evening and welcome to tonight's Driver's Ed class. Let me turn the music down here a little bit. So as we normally do, let's sign in. We've got our first week under our belt. Started to drive with a lot of you, which was a good thing this week. Quite pleased with what I've seen so far and how we're progressing along. So please sign in. We'll wait for the majority of people to come on before we get going. You couldn't ask for better weather, so next couple days, if you haven't driven yet, I would say grab a time to drive, because driving in this kind of weather is awesome. Starting to get everybody. Perfect. Good. Good, good, good. Missing about four or five people, and then we're ready to go. I will mention this again at the end of tonight's class, but I have two openings for driving tomorrow. I have 2 o'clock and 5 o'clock open. So if someone who hasn't driven would like to drive, and if no one signs up, if someone that has driven but wants to get another hour logged in with me, 2 o'clock, 5 o'clock is available. And we'll talk about that when we get near the end of tonight's program. Let me get out of here just a little bit, out of the music. So let's kind of get out of here. All right, that's it for music. We still got a few people. I can't take the attendance right now, but it looks like we're still missing a few people. A couple questions about the homework before we move on. My apologies. After last class, I went to a file that I had, and I just dragged over the instrument panel. So I believe that on one of the worksheets, I did not give you the blank. I gave you the answer sheet. So I still want you to try to write down what the instrument panel. I think I gave you the second page. Oh, that's the first one. That's the one I think that you have to do, because I didn't give you the answers. Here's the one that, there we go. So if you go to the Facebook page, this is what you would have gotten. You would have gotten all the symbols, but with what they are listed below. So that was kind of confusing. So people didn't know, well, what do you want me to do with this? Because it looks like it's already done. So my apologies. What I want you to realize is that there are a lot of symbols used in driving, on knobs, on levers, as lights, and anything that comes on the instrument panel that's lit. Excuse me. I want you to write this down. Anything that has a lighted symbol, if it is red, it needs your immediate attention. If it is yellow, it's cautionary, meaning that something is happening, but it's not something that you have to deal with right off. In my car, comes on a lot for an oil change. Just an exclamation point, and that's indicating my maintenance schedule for oil change has just been triggered, and I need to get an oil change. But a lot of these things, like with wipers and defrosters, these are going to be buttons and knobs, and you have to kind of know how to activate them and utilize them. So please try to do the one sheet that I did not give you the answers to. We'll probably go over that maybe near the end of Thursday's class. The other thing that you were supposed to do, and I didn't drag it out. Oh, here it is. I did drag it out. Some of you did. Oh, it's not coming on. Know your vehicle. I can see. I don't know if I can. It's not going to let me do it. Let me see if I can make this into a PDF. So hold on a second. I'm going to try to do this into a PDF. And if this will work. I don't know if I can find it now. I think I made it. I may have to, when we have a video coming up, I'll have to look for it. My apologies. I didn't have it primed. I thought I had the PDF. I have an Apple computer, and sometimes even within an Apple computer, things don't run right when you have to download stuff. So I'm looking on my screen. I don't see where it's listed. But to know your vehicle, I do want that done. So the instrument panel, do the blank one that I did include on Facebook, and do know your vehicle. Tonight's homework is going to be a little different. If you take a look at your sheet that I gave you when you... if you couldn't find certain aspects of the know your vehicle bulbs or fuses, you don't have to worry. I don't expect you to be able to complete everything. I will kind of go over that probably on Thursday, but I do want you to know what a fuse is, where they're located. So this is just to kind of dig deep into your car manual so you have some familiarity with where things are located and what they are, because there's going to come a time where your parents aren't going to be able to bail you out all the time. And even if you're not near a mechanic, you should be able in a parking lot kind of figure out some of these basic things that your car needs or what needs to be replaced, and you should be able to do it. We're not talking about being a technician, automotive technician, major repairs, but we're talking about maintenance things that you should be familiar with. So we'll probably get into that on Thursday. So I didn't want to spend too much time on that. But on tonight's homework, it's all about safety equipment. So tonight's class is all about safety. We talked about last week, we talked about the HTS, we talked about getting to know your vehicle. So now we're kind of getting into getting inside the car, moving the vehicle, using our eyes, learning how to make good turns, what should we do at stop lines and traffic lights. So we're starting to really kind of get into more of the meat of what driver's ed is really all about. So tonight is really focused on three safety devices: seatbelts, airbags, and helmets. Now, we need to talk about helmets a little bit because some of you may want to get a motorcycle license. We do encounter motorcycles out on the road, scooters, even people on bikes. Having a helmet on will prevent trauma to the brain, and we're going to see an interview with someone that had a motorcycle crash and what his life is like now. And what it could have been like if he didn't have his helmet on. But his helmet helped him out. So we're going to take a look at his testimony a little bit later tonight. So let's kind of pop right into tonight's topic of seatbelts, airbags, and helmets. And what is the real story? Do I really need these items? Do I really need to have my seatbelt on? Look how safety has changed. I mean, back probably when your parents were much younger, this was the common way to transport young children. And we can just take a look at this picture right now. And we basically know that if this car had to stop real quick, there is no way this child isn't going to be getting a mouthful of metal from that rod. There is no cushion on that metal rod. That little strap is not going to keep her from moving forward. And that doesn't even look like strong metal that's going to prevent the child from maybe even breaking away from that device and hitting the dashboard. But in our mind, and back then, we felt this was being a responsible adult. This was keeping kids safe. And it's the furthest thing from the truth. And even with airbags now, a lot of times we think, because my car has an airbag, I don't need my seatbelt. And that is furthest from the truth too, because an airbag is only going to be effective if you're behind the steering wheel or behind where the airbag is being deployed from. So we'll talk more about that. We've done many, many studies, statewide, federal, type of surveys, and we have found that young adults age 18 to 24 are less likely to wear their seatbelts. Now, why don't they test people between 16 and 18? Or why doesn't the survey include that? Basically, because parents have a strong pull in what you're doing. And if a lot of you have parents that ever found you out driving, let's say what may happen, and they knew that you weren't doing what you're supposed to, they would probably restrict your driving privileges. And coming out of driver's ed, wanting your license, more people tend to follow laws right after driver's ed, and then they tend to get a little bit lax once they go off to college, once they move away. They think they know everything about driving, and their driving attitude basically changes. And I don't think the second bullet here is any surprise to anyone, but men are less likely to wear seatbelts than women. Men have a tendency to think that they're, you know, they excel at driving. If there's going to be a crash, it's not going to be their fault. It's going to be somebody else. But that just leads to the question, you don't have to be a bad driver to be involved in a crash. You could be an exceptional driver, but it's the other people that are coming into your path that you've got to protect yourself. So that's why you should always have your seatbelt on. We also find that adults who live in non-metropolitan areas are less likely to wear seatbelts than adults who live in metropolitan areas. Because we think we're out in Durham and Lee. I mean, we may not even see three or four cars on our way to school, depending on what route we take. So why should I have my seatbelt on? I'm only going to the dump. But when we live in a city, because you're going on ramps and off ramps and got a lot of traffic lights and people running lights, well, I better have my seatbelt on. And by that is a good thing to think that way. So seatbelt use is lower in states with secondary enforcement. And we're going to talk about secondary enforcement in a minute. And the last thing I want you to write down in your notes is rear seat motor vehicle passengers are less likely to wear seatbelts. For some reason, people think because you're in a front seat, passenger or driver, well, I better have my seatbelt on. But if you're in the back of the car, it's like party, party, party. You know, I don't want to be restricted. I want to be able to move around. I really don't need it. I've got a seat in front of me. If you get involved in a crash, I'm going to get pushed into that seat. I'm not hitting a steering wheel. I'm not hitting a windshield. So people in the back seat are less likely probably to have their seatbelt on. Now, this has changed slightly. So this is, you know, almost 10 years old. So of course it's going to change a little bit differently. But I will tell you, because I want you to focus only on New Hampshire right now. We are surrounded by, of course, Vermont, Maine, and Massachusetts. We are one of the least seat-belted state in the country. We're one of, I think, only a few that does not have a primary law for adults in seatbelts. Almost every other state has one. And here's a question that I want to pose to you. Once you get your driver's license in the next month or so, and you drive out of the state of New Hampshire, and you, let's just say that you go to Connecticut. Okay, it's a little bit of a drive. You're going to go visit your cousin. What would happen if you get stopped in a state and you don't know their seatbelt law? Can you still get a ticket? That's a good question, isn't it? Think about it. If I drive into a different state, what type of responsibility do I have in knowing their laws? You should know. Okay? You can get so much information on your phone, on the internet. There are signs posted. Most major laws with driving, seatbelts, distracted driving, and alcohol, almost every time you go into another state, you will see probably one of those topics being spoken about or indicated on a sign telling you what your responsibility is. And the answer to the question that I just gave is yes, you will be given a ticket, regardless if you know what the law is. So it's your responsibility to know when you go from state to state to state, what are the main concerns? Distracted driving, seatbelt laws, alcohol when you get of age, speeding, Okay. But we have speed limit signs all around. But here's New Hampshire, one of the lowest states for usage of seatbelts. So here is what I want you to write down in your law, in your notes about laws. When it comes down to laws, they're broken into two categories, primary and secondary. So what I want you to write down is a primary law indicates that that alone, if you break a law, that alone can get you a ticket, a moving violation. So the example that they give here, so an officer who sees you run a red light or drive through a school zone at 90 miles per hour can lawfully pull you over and give you a ticket. That is a primary offense. You went too fast, you got a ticket. You ran a stop sign, you got a ticket. Okay, now here is the rub. Here is the rub where a lot of people don't understand this. A lot of seatbelt laws are secondary traffic laws. You cannot get ticketed for this offense unless there was another offense, a primary offense being broken. So let's go down to the bottom here. It says, state laws vary, but many jurisdictions allow only secondary enforcement for distracted driving, seatbelt, violation of your learner permit restrictions, and having a headlight out. However, some types of secondary offenses can also be primary offenses in certain situations. For example, in some states, when a seatbelt violation is a primary or secondary offense, depends on the age of the person. And that's the case here in New Hampshire. It is a primary offense if you're under 18. We do not have a primary for an adult. Now, George just gave a question up here on the YouTube section on comments. Is yes, if you get a ticket from another state, you can pay online. You do not have to go to court. You have that option. Now, most states, when they see an out-of-state license plate, they know most people will not fight the ticket. They'll probably pay for it online because that means time away from school, time away from work. If it's a real bad offense, they may even have to have an attorney. So a lot of people will say, I'll just plead guilty. I'll pay whatever fine it is. I'll lose my license for whatever time frame it is. And then they go from there. So what I want you to write in your notes, secondary offenses can only happen if a primary offense has been broken. So if you don't have your seatbelt on in another state, but you were speeding, they can give you two tickets. If they only see you drive by without your seatbelt on, you're going the speed limit, but they know you don't have your seatbelt on, they can't pull you over, even though there's a secondary offense. They have to have a primary of why they pulled you over and then notice that you don't have your seatbelt on. So what is the impact of seatbelt use? What I want you to realize, and you don't have to write this down because like I said, I'm not going to test you on numbers per se, but we're basically saving lives to the tune of about 10 to 15,000 a year. We're losing, we're gaining safer drivers because of the way cars are being built now. Less people are dying behind the wheel of a car than ever before because of safety equipment. And research shows primary enforcement seatbelt laws do make a big difference. People do not like to get a ticket. Because as you get tickets, your insurance will go up. And a way to change people's attitudes and behaviors is to hit them in the pocketbook and to put them on the sidewalk walking rather than driving. So if you have to walk to work or walk to school and you have to pay a fine, we have found that people will change their attitude and their behavior. If we do not do this to a point where it is a penalty, then people will pay out of pocket. If it's just a little bit of a hurt, a little bit of a bite, the sting isn't too bad. So we have to kind of make it where people are saying, it's not worth me getting a ticket. So I'm going to put my seatbelt on. So what can states do? And we're always looking at how to make things better. And by the way, I haven't looked online because even the driver's ed teachers get together about once a year and we have conferences and we talk about topics and information from the state. The last thing, because we haven't met because of COVID, and I'm going to meet with them this Sunday online on Zoom, so I may ask the question, is what is coming down the pike in New Hampshire on seatbelts? Last thing I heard that New Hampshire is pushing to make a mandatory seatbelt law for adults. That's the last thing that I heard. They're trying to push it through to finally get, you know, the state to, you know, get in line with everybody else. So I'll let you know next week after I talk to a few people on Sunday. So basically, what this is supposed to tell us here is that we've got different ways that we can affect traffic law, is that we can make our lawmakers understand that we want safer roads. We want people to have less injury. We don't want people to die. So we want laws that will hopefully change people's attitudes and behaviors. So the states can basically change laws to whatever they want. So that's what the states can do. Make sure that the police actually go out and enforce this. Now, I'm not one that you should get a ticket every single time. I'm not one that even though you're breaking a law, you should always get a ticket. I truly believe there are times that things happen when we aren't realizing that they're happening. There are times that we may be unaware. Like I said, when you move from state to state or drive from state to state, it's natural that you just didn't look online. You just didn't read the sign when you went over the border, that you don't know what's going on. If I'm a state trooper and I see someone from, let's say, Connecticut driving in New Hampshire, I'm going to just give them a warning. Hey, here in New Hampshire, this is how we do things. Give them a warning. Now, you can actually note, you know, in like a note section on a computer system so people will know if you go someplace else in New Hampshire, they'll see that you got stopped by a state trooper down around the Durham area. So now you can't say, well, I didn't know. Well, yeah, the last guy that pulled you over 2 weeks ago because you have a summer home here, you basically know. We told you. So they're going to give you that ticket. We're finding even health professionals are making inroads of changing people's behavior. When you go to see a doctor, a lot of times they'll ask about high-risk behavior, like do you smoke? Do you drink? Do you not wear your seatbelt? Do you talk on the phone while you drive? Because they know eventually, you know, maybe they're going to see you in an emergency room because you've been involved in a crash. So a lot of times they'll just give you a survey to answer to see what your risk is and, you know, what your attitude is towards certain behaviors. Parents, okay, a lot of times have to set the example, have to say, if you're going to use the family car, once you get your license, we know it's the law under the age of 18, you got to be seatbelted. Parents should hold you to that. And if they find out that you're driving without it, there should be repercussions at home. I know at my house, especially since I teach driver's ed, my kids knew. They do anything bad behind the wheel of the car, dad's going to come down pretty hard on him. Okay, and I can say that none of my kids have received a moving violation. Now, my son, on the other hand, he's had plenty of warnings, but he's never had a written ticket, thank goodness. So we're going to kind of get into some of the technical things now. This is just on New Hampshire, I think, in gender. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. In New Hampshire, in a span of roughly 9 years, 919 motor vehicle occupants were killed in New Hampshire. And we can see the national average. We're below the national average, which is a good thing because we don't have a primary offense, yet we see a lot of people. Are less people in New Hampshire dying than what we're seeing in the other 49 states. But males by far, almost triple. Look at in the middle where it says death, rate of deaths by gender. Male, 7.3 per 100,000. Females, 2.8. Okay, almost triple the amount. And then restraint use national level is we can see 86%. On a national level, because of primary law, 86% of the people nationally wear seatbelts, but in New Hampshire, only 69. We can't get away from what our license plate says, live free or die. That's our motto, and I think that's how everybody believes. It's almost like the mask. Isn't that kind of strange when you think about what we've just gone through in the last year? And you've probably seen it in the news. You've seen it in the stores. Some people don't want to wear a mask because you're infringing on their freedom. Well, seatbelts is the same type of thing. It's my freedom if I don't want to wear a seatbelt. But the thing that I want you to realize, and I do want you to write this down in your notes, is that if you choose not to wear your seatbelt once you become 18 in New Hampshire, which you, as of right now, you can do. When you're 19, you don't have to wear a seatbelt. But when you're involved in an injury or if there's a death and your insurance company is paying out damages, you got to remember that does affect you if you don't wear your seatbelt. Because everybody is going to have to pay for those injuries and the cost of that death. So the insurance companies will pass that on to everybody, even those that are wearing their seatbelt. Your rates go up according to your injuries and deaths per state. So in your notes, I want you to write down, insurance rates are based upon driving behavior in your state. So if you were to move to Maine, you're the same age, driving the same car, you're just living in a different state, your insurance rate will be different than it is in New Hampshire. Okay, so you need to realize, we're going to talk about insurance a little bit further down the road, but I want you to realize that all your friends, I shouldn't say your friends, but people that are in their 20s not wearing their seatbelts and they get involved in injuries, and if there's deaths, that's going to raise everybody's insurance rates, even though you're doing everything you're supposed to do. Here's the article that I found just before the shutdown last year from everything that we were doing at school, and we moved everything on remote. So I found this that's just indicating that New Hampshire is trying to push for mandatory seatbelt laws for people in the front seat. That's kind of interesting. They only want it in the front seat, it says here. But look how cheap the fine is. The bill would assess $50 fine for drivers, $25 for passengers in the front seat. Okay, most people would say, fine, you know, I'll pay a $50. That's almost a parking fine. When you illegally park in Durham, it's probably pretty close to $50. So it's the same type of thing. So let's think about why we should be wearing our seatbelt. One of the things that I want you to think about, and by the way, I don't think I mentioned about the homework. So the homework tonight is you have a project to do. And the project, so write this down, is you have three choices. So choose one. You can do a poster. You can do a radio ad. You can do a video. Okay, so you can do a poster. You can do a radio ad. You can do a video. You have to do one of those projects on safety equipment. So it could be seatbelts. It could be airbags. It could be helmets. All right. So here is why you would want to be restrained with a seatbelt. So here is, and I don't show many gory type of videos, but this one has to do with being thrown from a vehicle. So watch this. So you're going straight down the highway. No traffic in front of you. Traffic is really busy on the other side of the road. Now watch up ahead. Someone's going to cross over and hit another car. And there you're going to see a person being thrown up in the air. Okay, that was a person being thrown. Let's see if I can go back. Oh, I'm going to bring this back just a little bit more. So right here. Okay, now watch the Jeep. See, the Jeep is trying to avoid someone that's crossing the center line. You see it where it's crossing over? Hits the Jeep. The Jeep gets flipped. Okay, that's the Jeep. And that's the person being thrown in the air right there. Okay, you want to stay in your vehicle. Notice he was driving fine. There was nobody in front of you, in front of us right now, but someone crossed over that little area right there and caused the problem. So Some of these I don't have anymore. Okay, I do want you to write this down. The movement of your body, even though you're in a seatbelt, your body is still going to move forward. So what I want you to write down, your head is going to move about 1.9 feet. So that's going to go the furthest distance. This is why you want to be a good distance away from the steering wheel. Your chest is going to go about 1.3 feet, and then your pelvis about 1.2. Now, this is at 30 miles per hour, so we're talking about driving in town. The faster you go, your body's going to move a little bit more because you've got more weight going into the seatbelt. If you don't have your seatbelt nice and tight and taut, then you're going to have some more movement and you're going to even go closer to the seatbelt. What this is trying to say is get far enough away from your steering wheel to allow the airbag to do its job, okay, and to make sure that you have the seatbelt nice and tight so you get full benefit of the seatbelt, because you don't want to be hitting the dash. Now, here's a car that isn't really in that great a shape. We're making cars so much better than that now. And this just goes to show that there was going to probably be some leg injury here down near the ankle, below the knee. There should never be that type of damage to the side of the car. And we're building cars so much better now that we're not seeing that. I'm going to see. I don't see the. Hold on a second. I'm going to try to find something here. I'm trying to find a clip. Okay, I think I found it. Let's see if I can bring it in on here and play it.
The car is king. In the last 30 years, the number of cars on the road has trebled, and more cars means more accidents. 20 million people around the world are injured in road accidents every year, and over 1 million people are killed. That's equivalent to the entire population of Barcelona. But amazingly, although the number of accidents is going up, the number of deaths is actually going down. In the past,
why is it that some...
Okay, I got out of that. I tried to drop it in. It didn't work. I don't know why it's not showing it anymore. Okay, I don't have that one readily available. So I'm going to have to show that tomorrow. All right. So we'll go away from airbags. There it is. I'll have to show that tomorrow. So what I want you to write down, these two terms, passive and active. What is a safety equipment that's passive? Passive means that you don't have to do anything. You just need to buy a car that has it. So an airbag would be a passive device. Some seatbelts come across when you close the door automatically on some high-end cars. That would be a passive restraint. Anything that's manual would be something that you have to do. So your lap belt, you have to reach over, grab it, click it. Shoulder belts, same thing. Sometimes trucks, Jeeps will have what they call a three-point door-mounted combination belt. That is something that you have to do. And we'll see more about child restraints. You've got to use a booster seat or some type of rear-facing seat for a toddler at a certain age to transport them. So those would be active devices. Here's more information on an airbag. You may want to use this for your poster. So anything that we go over tonight, if you want to grab one or two, and what I want for the poster is I want two facts, and I want you to use some graphics and some color, make it colorful. It only has to be about the size of a piece of paper. It doesn't have to be on poster board. Same thing with the radio ad and the video. I want a couple facts about what we're talking about, or you could research the facts and use something that you find about airbags that you find interesting. What you're trying to do is to point something out to someone and change their attitude towards the use of seatbelts or airbags or helmets. With airbags, they're only effective if you're far enough away. So what I want you to write down, you want to be at least 10 inches away from the steering wheel. that if you are under the age of 12, it'd probably be wise not to be in the front seat. You should be in the back, or disable the airbag. And an airbag will only be effective if you have a seatbelt. Let me get out of here and let me show you what I'm talking about. Anytime that you're driving a car and you don't have your seatbelt on and you get hit, your body is going to move inside the car. You get hit front, side, left, right, whatever, your body's going to move away from the steering wheel. So if you've got an airbag with no seatbelt on, you're going to get hit, you're going to move away, and then the airbag's going to come out right here. You want it right here. You want the airbag between your shoulders. This is where you want your airbag to come out. So that's why it's so important to have your seatbelt on. Now, airbags come in all different areas around the vehicle. We have them in the area of our legs now, near our shoulders and our head. On SUVs, they even have them on the roof of some SUVs. But the ones we're familiar with are the airbags that are in the steering wheel and just above where the glove compartment is, because we think of the front seat passengers getting the brunt of the crash. Keeping your feet on the dashboard. Did you know that airbags deploy between 100 and 220 miles per hour? That is super fast. So if you ride with your feet on the dash, you may send your knees through your eye sockets. So what I want you to do with the comment section here on YouTube, because I want to see who's still here, because we're all down to 14, so I'm going to make a list of who's here. I want you to write down, have you ever put your feet on the dashboard? All right? So I want you to put in a comment, yes or no, on YouTube, so I can actually, while we watch this video, I want you to write yes or no so I can see who is still here, because we've just lost a ton of people watching. Okay, thank you for responding. I'm going to be able to take a tally of those that were still here participating in class. So I appreciate that. Thank you very much. So the answer to the question of why you should not be putting your feet up is because of brain trauma. Brain trauma will happen anytime you have like a concussion. So when your knees are coming at you at those speeds of 100 to 220 miles per hour, this is what's going to happen. This is what your forehead's going to look like. Here's a girl that had her feet on the dash. Okay. And it's going right up into her forehead. And this is after surgery. So I imagine it looked a lot worse. And we don't know what type of learning problems that she may be having right now. So head trauma is such a serious business. With safety belts, let's just kind of talk about where to adjust them. The thing that no one has done so far, the driving with me, there is a retractor for your shoulder harness, which means that on the post where the seatbelt is connected, if it's riding too high, and I guess it probably hasn't been riding too high, or else you probably would have asked me, how do I prevent this? But you need to move down the retractor so your shoulder harness would be across your shoulder blades and not up around your chin in your ear. But no one's had that problem yet. Seat position's a big deal. Make sure that you're sitting upright in the seat, a good comfortable position. You should always think about not only using your hands to steer the steering wheel, but think about your position as where the airbag's going to be coming out from. I wish I had that video lined up. I don't know what I did with it. It's such a good video. Anyway, so these are reasons why people don't wear seatbelts, and they're all a myth. They're all can be refuted with facts, and that's what we're doing here. The myth is that some people actually do believe that being thrown from the car is not a bad thing because you're getting hit so violently, you'd probably die inside the car. No, you probably would be more likely to die if you get thrown from the vehicle, as we just saw in the clip earlier today. Will people live and be thrown from a car? Sure. Yeah, you're one of those miracles. You know, it does happen, but I'd much rather have the protection of my car if I'm in my seatbelt with an airbag. I'll take my chances. If it catches fire, if a car catches fire or goes into water, I'm not going to be able to get out. That's a myth. It doesn't take too much time to unlock your seatbelt and to get out from some emerging car or a car that's being caught on fire. And then when it comes to children, I can better protect my child by holding them. There's no person that can hold a child and keep them from hitting the dash or whatever. If you're in the back seat, the seat that's in front of you, you're going to be using your child like a protective cushion or an airbag. Your child's going to take the brunt of the crash. So those are all myths. I do want to show you this clip. It's a little bit of a long video. It's very technical. It's probably the most scientific video that I show. But what I want you to focus on, and I want you to do this. Now, here's where I want you to, I'll get out of here for a second. So now I'm going to ask you a question, but you've got to answer the questions on your phone. I do not want the answers on YouTube. Okay, so these answers are not on YouTube. I want them on the phone so I have a record that you've watched the video and you know what the answers are. Now, during the video, they're going to show you a crash where a car is hitting something. Now, what they're going to try to explain is how all these safety equipment things will help prevent injury. And it's also going to talk about what are some of the injuries that will take place, maybe even if you are in a seatbelt. Are you going to always be able to walk away from a crash? And you'll find out the answer is no. So watch the video. They're going to talk about three types of crashes. So let's see if I can find this up here. Let's see if I actually come this up right. Let's see if this works. Okay, here we go. There are three collisions in a crash. Please text me on your phone the answer. So I'm going to keep that up there during the video, so it's only fair. So watch this and text me your answers.
Why is it that some spectacular race car crashes produce only minor injuries? How can three collisions occur in this one crash between a car and a wall? The answers are determined by the laws of nature and can best be explained when physics meets biology. Through injury biomechanics, the study of the effects of forces on the human body, we've learned much about what happens in high-speed race car crashes, and doctors and engineers have used this information to build safer race cars and tracks. In a similar way, the study of injury biomechanics and crash testing has helped us learn what happens to the human body in passenger car crashes, and what works and doesn't work to reduce injuries and deaths in real-world crashes.
Hi, I'm Griff Jones. I'm a science teacher, and I'm here at the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety's Vehicle Research Center to explore the basic science behind injuries in vehicle crashes. So let's go behind the scenes and take a closer look at what happens to the human body in a crash. What is the first scientific discipline that comes to mind when you think of car crashes? It's probably physics, right? Because Newton's laws of motion govern what happens to a vehicle in a crash. But if we want to understand how crashes cause injuries to people, we need to look at what occurs when physical forces are applied to organs, tissues, and cells. This happens when physics meets biology in a field called injury biomechanics. The Institute's Vehicle Research Center is a world-class facility for vehicle research and testing. A reporter described the crash hall with its three runways as a cross between a Hollywood soundstage and a NASA cleanroom. Vehicles are propelled down the runways at precise speeds, using a system of nitrogen-powered hydraulic motors and cables. The lighting array provides up to 750,000 watts of non-glare illumination for the 500 frames per second high-speed cameras. The research tests they're conducting here today focuses on how injuries occur in real-world crashes. This experimental crash replicates one in which a car hit a tree. In an attempt to understand injury patterns found in the occupants of the actual crash, researchers have disconnected the airbags.
Looking at the driver's chest, we can see the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters of compression. The chest acceleration is 70 to 80 G, resultant acceleration range. High likelihood of skull fracture.
Very bad.
Yeah, very bad.
Figuring out what just happened in this test crash is the job of the research engineers here. Using sophisticated tools like instrumented crash test dummies, instrumentation in the car, and slow motion film, they can analyze every detail and construct a precise picture of exactly what the vehicle and the occupants went through. When research engineers use terms like the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters, how does that relate to what a human occupant would experience? If chest acceleration is 70 to 80 G's, which means that a force equivalent to 70 to 80 times the weight of the dummy's chest is pressing on it, is that survivable? How do these guys know the answers? The search for the limits of human tolerance to forces began decades ago. Today's race car and passenger car drivers benefit from biomechanics studies that were conducted during the 1940s, 50s, and 60s in the field of aviation, investigating how to protect pilots and astronauts from the strenuous forces of ejections and high-speed travel. Colonel John Stapp, a medical doctor and biophysicist in the United States Air Force, used himself as the test subject in his investigations of human tolerance to high-G environments.
From the outside, watch the breakneck stop.
In one of his many tests, Dr. Stapp reached a speed of 632 miles per hour before one of the most powerful braking systems of all time stopped him in 1.4 seconds, subjecting him to more than 40 times the pull of gravity, or 40 Gs. His research helped establish the limits of human tolerance to high G environments and saved many lives through development and improvement of protective systems for ejection seats. Realizing the Air Force lost nearly as many men to car crashes as they did to plane crashes, Dr. Stapp began a car crash program using the rocket sled for seatbelt experiments. Human volunteers working with his biophysics research team endured as many as 28 Gs during safety belt tests. This early research laid the foundation for the complex crash analysis that is conducted here today. These dummies are a perfect example of combining science, technology, engineering, and mathematics to produce new tools that extend scientific understanding. They are the modern-day version of Dr. Stapp's volunteers. There's not just one dummy for VRC testing, nor even one type. There's a whole family of dummies for crash testing.
This is our crash test dummy family, ranging from a six-month-old all the way up to a 95th percentile male.
95th percentile of what?
That means that it is larger than 95% of the male population in the U.S.
Wow, so this is a big guy.
Yes, if he could stand, he would be about 6'2", about 223 pounds, pretty big. The female, if she could stand, about 5 foot tall, 107 pounds.
How about the smaller dummies?
They're called crabbies.
Crabbies? Are they moody?
They're not moody, but it stands for child restraint airbag interaction.
And so when we're doing the frontal crash test, it's 50th percentile?
Yes.
Okay. Side impact is the small female.
Thought Impact Dummy is a very complicated dummy. It has the most instrumentation. They have sensors from the head to the toe. The accelerometers give us the acceleration of the mass. The load cell measures force. Mm-hmm. And then we have the potentiometers that measure the displacement the ribs actually move.
So dummies are very sophisticated. They provide data from many different body regions. But how do we connect this to people? What is the link between all these crash test data and the injuries that people experience in real-world crashes?
The dummy is measuring different things. It's measuring acceleration, force, and in some cases, distortion of the body parts. Those measurements can be compared against similar measurements made in experiments on biological tissues, using either animal models or cadaver models to get an idea of how much stress can this body part take before it breaks. So in order to understand whether or not a person would be injured, you need to know how strong the bones are, how strong the tissues are, and what conditions will cause them to break.
So the crash test dummies try to get a clearer picture of what's really happening to the people. Is that where the term biofidelity comes from?
It's exactly where the term biofidelity comes from. What biofidelity means is the characteristic of the dummy that represents how close to actually being a human being it is. So the higher the biofidelity, the more like a human being it is in representing how it moves, what types of stresses it measures in the crash test, and then the true to likeness of those measurements to the prediction of injury in a real person.
This is how research engineers can tell us with precision what a human occupant would have experienced in a test crash. Dr. Stapp's experiments, plus years of research with real biological tissues from cadavers and animals, have produced a set of reference values against which we can compare the stresses and strains the dummies experience. So, we can measure these in a test crash and can figure out if they would cause injury to a human occupant. But what do these stresses and strains actually do to people to cause injury? Let's start with some basic anatomy. Your body contains over 100 trillion cells and is structurally organized into four levels.
Here comes the answers.
Cells, tissues, organs, and organ systems.
They'll give you the three
collisions. Tissue is a group of similar cells working together to perform a common function. Organs are made up of two or more types of tissue working together to perform a specific function. And each organ is part of at least one organ system that performs major activities or processes. Your body contains four fluid-filled spaces called body cavities that house and protect your major internal organs. Within the body cavities, your organs are suspended in fluid that supports their weight and prevents them from being deformed by normal movements. Your organs are also protected by your bones and muscles. For example, your heart and lungs are protected by your rib cage and sternum inside the thoracic cavity. Your brain is encased within your cranial cavity and is protected by your skull. Now, with this as background, remember the question from the beginning of this film. How is it possible to have three collisions in a single crash? Remember, the laws of physics hold true everywhere, on a highway, on a racetrack, and even inside your body. If a race car is going 200 miles per hour, so is the driver's body and every organ inside it. Let's answer the question. The first collision is between the car and the wall. The second is between the driver and the car's interior. And the third is between the driver's internal organs and the inside walls of his or her body cavities. Tell me a little bit more about the injury. To help us understand more about what happens to organs in the third collision, let's meet Dr. Stephen Olvey, a neurocritical care physician and director of the Neuroscience Intensive Care Unit at the University of Miami's Jackson Memorial Hospital.
Basically, during a crash, you have three collisions. You have the initial crash of the vehicle.
Then you have the occupant hitting something inside the car and coming to a sudden stop.
This results in impacts inside the body. For example, the lungs can hit the inside of the rib cage. The heart can hit the breastbone or inside of the rib cage, resulting in either pulmonary contusion or myocardial contusion. This is what causes ruptured spleens, lacerated livers, because you have part of the organ well anchored and the other part is free to move about. And this causes a shearing force to take place in the organ, resulting in hemorrhage or tearing of the tissue. The brain is enclosed in a rigid case, the skull, and it's cushioned and surrounded by the cerebral spinal fluid. The cerebral spinal fluid is actually a different density than the brain itself, so in the event of an impact to the skull, the brain begins to move, the cerebral spinal fluid begins to move, but it moves at a different rate than the brain. So it will actually displace the brains in the opposite direction of the initial impact to the brain.
This simple experiment helps illustrate the phenomenon. This represents your skull. There's water inside representing your cerebral spinal fluid, and the red gel is your brain. The gel floats because it's less dense than water, just like your brain is less dense than your cerebral spinal fluid. What do you think will happen to the brain during impact? Will it move forward, backward, or stay in the same spot? Let's see. The initial movement of the brain is toward the back of the skull. The more dense cerebral spinal fluid moves toward the side of the skull impact, displacing the brain in the opposite direction. If the impact is strong enough, the brain will initially impact the back wall of the skull, then rebound and hit the front of the skull.
This type of injury is called a coup contre coup, which is a French term meaning blow against blow. The order of events inside the skull is still debated in the medical community. Whether the more dense fluid displaces the brain in the opposite direction first, or whether the brain moves in the direction of the initial impact first and then is displaced by a wave of spinal fluid, is not yet fully understood. By the way, this simple experiment was designed by a high school student for her science fair project. It was later published in a medical journal and has contributed to the debate. Crash injuries occur when stress develops in tissue. Another way this happens is when one part of the tissue or organ is firmly attached to the torso and another part is free to move. For example, with the heart and its blood vessels, the ascending aorta and its arch are mobile, while the descending aorta is fixed. Here's a demonstration of how a sudden stop, like a third collision, can cause an acceleration injury to the aorta. The aortic arch is represented by the unsupported gel. The gel inside the tube represents the descending aorta, which is fixed to the body.
Try to predict what will happen during the collision.
The unsupported section of gel continues forward and tears away from the supported gel. During an actual collision, the fixed descending aorta will decelerate along with the body, while the arch and ascending aorta's momentum keep them moving forward. This difference in acceleration or deceleration causes a tear where the fixed and mobile parts meet. Even the inertia of a blood-filled heart can cause stress and strain on the aortic arch.
We've been talking about stress and strain on tissues and organs, and we've seen how a crash applies some of these forces. But what is stress and strain in this context?
Stress is a measure of the average deforming force exerted over a defined area of tissue. Stress produces strain, which is a measure of how much the tissue deforms as a result of the stress.
This special gel has elastic properties similar to certain human tissue, but not all human tissue is of equal strength. Forces and pressures on the outside of your body cause stress within your tissue. Three basic types of stress are tensile stress from stretching, shearing stress from opposing forces, and compressive.
Now, I know that was pretty deep. It's pretty involved, but I wanted to kind of break things down for you, and it's really focusing about how delicate the human body is. So what I want you to realize is that when you're driving a vehicle, you've got to protect you and all your passengers, because any type of collision inside the car, everybody's going to be moving at different rates and at different angles. So when they were talking about stress and strain, and they're talking about your muscles and your organs, even with a seatbelt on, even with an airbag, even with a car that's built really well with metal, there's going to be some discomfort or strain or injury in a real serious crash. So anything that we can do to lessen that is what we want to do. So most of you did a perfect job. I gave you thumbs up. I think there's only one person that hasn't answered the question. So I'm very happy with that, because when I look at the screen, I can only see that there are numbers are going up and down. I don't see, according to your name, who you are. So I've got to find a way, and I'm doing this with the comments and your phone, to figure out who's still here and who's not, because you're supposed to be here in class. But anyways, okay, let's go through the three collisions. The first collision, okay, is with you hitting something, an object, a wall, whatever. So the car is hitting something else. That's the first. The second is that your body is hitting the inside of your vehicle. And then the third is your internal organs hitting the inside of your body cavity. So I want you in your notes, I want you to write this down, because I want you to think about this, because this is how you're going to see how you're losing control in that crash with each passing millisecond. Okay, how much control as a driver do you have over hitting something? You have a lot. So write that down. The first collision, hitting something, you have a lot of control over. You can accelerate. You can brake. You can steer around something. So you can lessen or avoid a crash a lot of times. Sometimes you can't, but you have a lot of control. Now, how much control do you have over your body hitting the steering wheel or the dashboard? Do you have a lot of control, some control, or no control? You have some control. The control that you have, you could put your seatbelt on. Could you still hit the steering wheel? Well, yeah. You just didn't tighten it up well enough, or you're sitting too close to the steering wheel and you're going to hit the dash or whatever. So there are things that you could do wrong even with your seatbelt on. So you have some control, but not total control. And then your organs hitting the inside of your body cavity, you have no control, because notice you're losing control as the crash is happening. And as we get to that last part, sometimes it's just your body makeup, just where the car, at what angle hits you, that you may survive the crash. Because internal organs, as you saw, the heart, many people in a crash, there we go, there's the last person. Okay, I just saw it come up here. And the last person just, okay. I got it. We're doing good. When your heart is moving inside your body cavity, there's going to be tension and stress. And a lot of times that aorta is going to rip away from where it's being attached. And this is where you have eternal bleeding. So a lot of times when you see people in a car crash, there's no blood on their face. Everything looks fine. You think, oh, they're in a seatbelt. They're going to be okay. Not necessarily. It all depends on where they get hit and at what speed. So any time that we can bring down our speed in a crash, the lower the impact, the less force our body is moving towards that steering column or the dashboard, or if you're in the back seat, towards the seats that are in front of you. So we want to do everything to protect us in a crash. So everybody did really good. I got the notes. I think I checked off here. I think I got everybody responding to the video. So I'm very happy with the participation on that video. Let's get back and talk about kids. I will tell you, I have three children, and I will admit one of the first times that I really realized what type of driver that I really am is when I brought my first child home from the hospital. What I'm saying is that if you think you're a good driver and you drive slow into turns and you go slow into stops, I will tell you, the minute you put a young child, a newborn child in your car and you're driving home, you are so slow with your stops. You're so slow with your turns because you're afraid that if you go too fast, the child's head will start rolling from side to side. You know, or if the child may start to cry, it will change the way you drive. I'm telling you, now you're going to have to wait, you know, a good amount of years before you see that. But maybe when you're with an older brother or sister, maybe with some friends, maybe you'll even be a babysitter and you're going to have a young child under the age of one in the car with you. You're going to drive different. You just are. So what should children do? And I'm only going to throw up a couple things here that I want you to be familiar with. Be very careful with the shoulder harness with young kids. They've got to be at least 40 inches tall. Anytime that you put a child in a car seat, think about, are they in a proper position to take benefit of that seatbelt? Because sometimes the seatbelt, if it's up too high, it will do some damage. So maybe a booster seat rather than sitting on a regular seat. So make sure that they're tall enough. If a child is less than six and less than 55 inches in height, then you're looking at, like I said, that booster seat. So the shoulder harness is 40 inches to use the shoulder harness, 55 inches to be at least taller than that to be seated in a regular seat. And of course, we know anyone under the age of 18 needs to be belted. So let's take a look at children and what we can do with children.
More than 1,000 children 12 and under die in car crashes every year. And more than 100,000 are injured. But parents can reduce the risk to their kids if they put them in an appropriate car safety seat that's correctly installed in their vehicle. When a vehicle is moving at 30 miles per hour, so is everything inside it. If the vehicle crashes, unrestrained objects keep moving at their original speed until they strike the vehicle interior. This is why infant and child car seats are so important. They hold child passengers in place as the vehicle's front end does its job of crumpling and absorbing energy. This test demonstrates something parents don't even want to think about: an unprotected infant smashing into the instrument panel. Some parents think it's okay to ride with a child on their lap, but it's not. Crashes happen so fast and are so violent that you can't protect a child this way. Frontal airbags can be especially dangerous. In a crash, an airbag can hit a child or car seat with tremendous force. Even older children shouldn't sit in the front seat. The temptation to play with the radio can put them in harm's way. Children are always safer in the back seat. The basic types of car seats are rear-facing infant seats, forward-facing child seats, convertible seats that can be used either rear or forward-facing, and booster seats for children who've outgrown their forward-facing seat but aren't big enough for adult seat belts. Consider your child's age and size when picking out a car seat and whether it's compatible with your vehicle's seat and seat belts. Not all car seats will fit well into your vehicle. Proper installation has always been a struggle, but it is getting easier. Since September 2002, passenger vehicles are required to have special anchors, and most car seats have to be made with attachments that fit into them. This system is called latch. Lower attachments mate with anchors in the seat. Anchor points are usually marked. For forward-facing seats, top tethers get attached to anchors on the rear shelf or on vehicle seat backs. Car seats and vehicles without latch are still safe if you use the vehicle's belt system correctly. In order to do this in some vehicles, you may need to use a locking clip. Keep in mind, a car seat that fits easily into one vehicle may not fit very well, if at all, into another. Before you buy a car seat, try it in your vehicle to be sure it's compatible and can be tightly secured. Also, be sure to read the seat and vehicle owner's manuals to make installation go more smoothly. In some communities, you can check the installation at county checking stations, police or fire stations, car dealerships, or hospitals. If you're in a severe crash, inspect your child's car seat. If there's visible damage, you'll need to replace it. Remember, your child's safety is up to you. Always be sure he or she is properly buckled in without fail every ride.
Okay, they went over quite a bit. Just a couple things I want you to write down is that if you only have one child in the back, put them in the middle. Think about if you were to get hit from the left or to the right and you had them on that side of the vehicle and you don't have an airbag back there. Okay, they're going to get the brunt of that car that's hitting you, that's T-boning you from the left or to the right. The safest place in any vehicle is in the middle. So put a child. Now, wonder if you have two. Then put it in the middle and then put one to the right side of the vehicle. And then if you have three, of course, they're going to have to be behind the driver. But it's really important to try to go in those sequence, because if you're going to get hit, and it's usually because you're going through a stop sign or a traffic light, I hate to admit it, but you're going to probably get hit on the driver's side more often than you are on the right side. It does happen, but it's usually when you've got a stop sign you're going through or a traffic light just turns green and you don't look to the left, someone's trying to beat that yellow light, which is now turning red. They're just going to hit you hard because they're going fast to beat that yellow light. So just remember where to put kids. And you can see that they had booster seats in that video, and how to use the latch. There's an area in the back underneath the crease of the seat where you can actually attach it and tighten it up. So hopefully you got some tips here. I would probably assume that most of you at some point in your life coming up will have kids in the car. Okay, whether it be relatives or if you're going to be babysitting. So you want to be responsible and show that you know where to put children and how not to use the shoulder harness if it's going to be rubbing them up around the neck, and, you know, just putting them in a safe position in the car. It goes a long way. Are people always going to be belted? No, because wonder if you own an antique that doesn't have a seatbelt. Okay, there's no way that you can use one. So the question is, if you have an antique without a seatbelt, can you drive in a state where it's a primary? Yes, you can. Okay, so you have a variance, okay, because they weren't built into the vehicle. Now, I don't know if they legally can have you try to retrofit and put one in a car. That's something I probably should make a note of and try to get an answer from somebody. But I believe antiques can stay in their original state. Of course, school buses. You've been on school buses. We don't have seatbelts on school buses. Don't ask me why. I think they should. Motorcycles, of course, don't have them. And if a child is in a wheelchair in a van, I think they're going to secure the van. And as long as you're in the wheelchair, you're going to be okay if you're tied into the wheelchair. Now, let's talk about helmet use a little bit. New Hampshire, just like with seatbelts, do not have a mandatory helmet law. It's only for people that are under the age of 18 that you have to have a helmet. So write that down. The only helmet law that we have is for those under 18. What we do have for everybody, though, is everyone must have eye protection. There's nothing worse than being on a motorcycle or a bicycle and getting something in your eye, trying to control the handlebars with one hand while you try to clear the crap out of your eye that just flew in. Could be dirt, could be a bug, it could be whatever. Okay, this is why helmets and goggles are a wise thing. And I think helmets should be used, but I understand the personal freedom that we have. But I also know, like I told you before, anybody that's involved in a motorcycle crash, head trauma is huge. Okay, and you don't want to be where you can't, you know, function as an adult. And a lot of people, when they have head trauma, they revert back to an age much younger than they are. So they revert back to when they were like 8, 10, 12. They can't analyze numbers or words or remember things, short-term memory. Big, big problem. So let's take a look at how do helmets actually work. So we're going to take a look at how helmets work.
How helmets work to protect your brain. For every mile traveled in the U.S., motorcyclists are 37 times more likely than drivers to be in a fatal crash. Motorcyclists without helmets are over 3 times more likely to suffer a brain injury. And each year, just in the U.S., about 800 more motorcyclists could have been saved from death by wearing a helmet. Let's first look at how brain injury happens during a motorcycle crash. The skull is like a bus. The different parts of the brain are like passengers right next to each other. Imagine that a school bus hits a wall, smashing right into it, a total mess. The bus is crushed and the passengers thrown about, everything flying. It's much the same in a direct head impact. A person's head smashes into something and suddenly there's a mess, blood everywhere, and inside the skull, torn tissue and broken blood vessels. The damage is obvious. But suppose the bus driver somehow managed a panic stop. The bus looks okay, no damage to the outside, but inside there'd still be a mess. Kids and their stuff everywhere, lots of cuts and bruises. The force from that panic stop would reach inside the bus and rattle the contents while leaving the bus unmarked. The same has been seen in helmeted head impacts. If a severe impact overwhelms the helmet, the face and skull might look okay. There might be no blood or fractures apparent, but inside, just as with the school bus, there's chaos. There can be stretched and torn neurons, broken blood vessels, and a host of injuries. Bleeding leads to more pressure inside the skull, damaging brain cells. Brain cells do not like to be touched by blood cells directly. These injuries can result in serious health and behavioral problems, and even death. But say the driver is really good. She sees the wall and applies the brakes firmly but carefully. The bus slows to a controlled stop just short of the wall. But now the kids remain seated and hang on to their books and backpacks. When they get to school, the children can tell their friends and teachers about their close call. It works the same for people wearing good helmets. When the helmet strikes, it stops moving almost immediately. But the helmet's thick inner liner allows the person's head to remain in motion for a while longer. The liner, as it is crushed, applies a controlled braking force to the head to slow it to a gentle stop. So long as the head is stopped before the helmet runs out of liner, the impact is softened to a tolerable limit. A truly protective helmet is constructed with a foam liner to cushion the head and a hard shell to prevent penetration. The hard shell spreads the impact force over a larger area of the liner, just like a thumbtack spreads the pushing force over the thumb. Having a good helmet on your head is like being on the right side of the thumbtack.
Ow!
The Snell helmet standard for motorcycling is the most stringent in the world. Snell M2015 certified helmets protect the brain in both low and high energy impacts and assures you the same head protection enjoyed by most competitive racers. Snell M2015 demands all the protective performance currently available to riders.
Okay, one of the things that they talked about a helmet doing is that it prevents the head from hitting the hard shell. So there's a soft cushion. So you know, it's kind of like a seatbelt for your head, that cushion is. So what I want you to write down, and I put it up here. I typed it in a text box here. I'll move it up here. It's called ride down. Anytime that you're slowing anything down, the car, your organs, your brain, the speed is slowing down, what they call ride down, to prevent serious damage. So in the helmet, they use that terminology, ride down, of the brain hitting the skull of your head. So I just want to throw that down, and we'll see how many people remember that on a quiz or on the midterm, ride down. So just want to throw that up there. I thought this was an interesting article. When we talk about changing people's attitudes and behavior, so on any issue, there's going to be pros and cons. So a lot of people are pro-helmet because they want to prevent injury and death. And then there's going to be cons where people have personal freedom. They don't like the feeling of a helmet. They want to feel the air going through their hair. I thought this was kind of ironic that someone was doing an anti-helmet law rally on his motorcycle. You've seen these big groups of motorcycles going down the road together. Well, in New York, they were having a rally, and one of the individuals who was protesting the new helmet law in New York didn't control his motorcycle, and he went over the top of his handlebars and hit his head on the pavement, and guess what happened? He died. And guess what would have happened if he had a helmet? He would have lived. Doesn't really help your cause to have one of your members that's protesting have head trauma and die from not wearing a helmet. So I clipped that article, and here it is right here. So I thought that was just kind of ironic. So helmets do make a difference. Here's the testimony, and I want you to see from this guy. Now, you're going to notice from the video that his life is not perfect anymore, but he's making a a bad situation better. And I really like what he's saying, is that even though in your driving career, some things are going to happen to you, some will be your fault, some won't be your fault, but you've got to continue on, have a positive attitude with life, and make the most of things. So I really like his testimony. So let me show you. I even forgot what his first name is.
Hey YouTube, it's Brian. Today's video I feel is very long overdue. Kind of wanted to talk about my motorcycle accident and more importantly, the helmet that I was wearing in the accident. In 2009, I was pulling out of my work parking lot. I was pulling onto a fairly busy road and there was a bunch of parallel parked cars on the side of the road. So when I pulled out, I turned right and I didn't see an oncoming car that was actually speeding. And right after I pulled out, the road started to curve. So what happened was I pulled out, saw this car coming, floored the bike trying to get out of the way, and got a little too close to the curve, the actual curb of the road. And there were a bunch of trees on the side of the road, and I happened to tip the bike over against the curb and slammed headfirst into a tree. I was doing about 35 miles an hour, not anything crazy fast, but this is what happened to my helmet after the accident. As you can see, I caved in the entire top of the helmet. As a result, this broke my spinal cord, and from the chest level down, I'm now paralyzed. So I know you're probably thinking, you know, why would I want to listen to a guy who was paralyzed talk about helmet safety? Well, there's quite a few reasons. First being that I have zero brain injury. That was the biggest thing. My injury is completely physical, which has allowed me to do a lot of things. Obviously, I can still work. I co-manage a group of over 30 people. I can actually still take care of myself. I can take care of my bathroom routine. I can get myself dressed. I am fully independent. I'm married. I have a beautiful wife. I have a great job. I have, you know, a sports car. I like to autocross my car, which is a form of racing, and I do that quite a bit. I still work on cars. That's something that I've always really loved to do. So there's a lot of things in my life that I don't think I would have been able to do had I had a brain injury. As you can see, I wouldn't have even had that chance had I slammed headfirst into a tree. I would have been completely dead. There was no way that I would be sitting here talking to you today. I actually went through rehab with a guy who had a similar accident. He was going through an intersection on his bike. A car was coming through, ran a red light. He slammed into that car, flipped off his bike, and he didn't have a helmet on. And he hit his head real hard on the concrete. He was not the same guy that he was before. He it basically knocked him back to third grade. When he was in rehab, he was tripping over himself. He was rambling. You know, he would just start talking, you know, gibberish. He just wasn't present. He wasn't himself. And that is one thing, the biggest thing, aside from my life, that this helmet has saved, is my brain and my personality. When it comes to brain injuries, it can vary as far as what your symptoms are. It's all about where your brain was injured. So there's people who have lost complete memory. They actually have to write things down throughout the day to keep track of what they've done. If they went to the bathroom, you know, if they just anything throughout the day, they're actually writing it down. Their speech can be impaired. All these things are preventable from wearing a helmet. There's a lot of people who were married and they ended up getting divorced as a result of their brain injury because, you know, they might be very hard to take care of. Or the other thing is, since their personality is so much different, there's women that have said, you know, this isn't the same man that I married. That is one thing that I feel like I still have. I still have my personality. I'm still the same person. I can still joke. I can still do everything, you know, mentally that I could do before my accident. Obviously, there are some restrictions from a wheelchair, but I've overcome quite a bit of stuff. I even, believe it or not, I even modified my motorcycle to ride post-injury. It had little legs that folded down, and a electric shifter. So what I would do is I'd push a button, the legs would fold up out of the way, and I would ride again. So that was one thing right after my injury that really kind of kept my mind out of the dark side. Obviously, I had a couple times where I thought about committing suicide. I didn't think that I could live my life from a wheelchair, or at least not have a quality, you know, life. I've found that that's complete bullshit. I have a great life. You know, like I said, I've got a great wife. I still hang out with friends. I still go on vacation. I still go swimming. I still do pretty much everything that I used to do. I just do it a little bit differently. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. I know people that ride motorcycles are extremely hard-headed. I was one of them. My accident, I thought, you know, if I ever got in an accident that I would break a leg or I would break my arm. I never imagined that I would smash into a tree and be paralyzed. But then again, if I hadn't been wearing the helmet, I would be dead. That would have been end of story for me. And I don't have the brain injury, like I said. So I can still do everything that I did before, just a little bit differently. Another thing I've still been able to do is watch my niece and nephew grow up, just to see them from a little baby and, you know, the toddlers they are right now. To watch a child grow is just an amazing thing. I think, you know, if I was already a father, there's no way in hell I'd be on a motorcycle myself. But think about that. I mean, if you got killed, who's going to take care of your kids? And do you really want them growing up without a father, or growing up with a father with a brain injury who can't take care of them? I think that is the biggest reason. If you are going to choose to get on a bike, you need to get a helmet and you need to wear it. Don't have it strapped to the side of the bike as you're going down the highway. That's not going to help, because anything can happen. That's one thing I've figured out. I took an advanced riding course 2 weeks before my injury. I mean, I was a safe rider. I did everything I thought I should. I wore the full gear, and stuff happens. I mean, it's just how it works, especially these days with everybody on their cell phones constantly. Accidents are everywhere around the corner, and if you're on a motorcycle, you don't have a cage around you. You're not in a car. You don't have an airbag. You're pretty much exposed to anything and everything on the road. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. If you have any questions, write in the comments below, and I'll talk to you soon. Thanks a lot.
I thought Brian did a very good job of explaining what happened to him. I thought his outlook is just fantastic, so positive, able to do a lot of things. I noticed that he was only going around 35 miles per hour, he said, but he did pull out in front of a car that he didn't see because of parked cars. Can you imagine the driver, how they felt? Okay, they probably didn't see him. He said that they were speeding, but doesn't look like that road 35 would be speeding. It looks like it would be a 35 mile an hour road. So just wanted you to see, you know, someone's point of view about the importance of wearing a helmet. So what I want you to do for your homework for tonight, okay, so you got a half hour to do this. So use the time, and also you got to do some reading for tomorrow. So let's do with a reading. Chapter 6 and 7 with questions from responsible driving, and you have section 5 and 8 in the state manual. That's what we're going to be covering tomorrow. So we're going to be doing vision, communication, and turning. The poster is due tomorrow. So use this time, this last half hour of class, to do your poster. I want two facts, like give me some percentage of how many people would be saved. Something that we went over tonight in class, or something that you find online. How many people would still be with us if they were seatbelted in New Hampshire, something like that. But being thrown from the car, you're 7 times less likely to die if you stay within, you know, the confinements of your vehicle. So you can choose seatbelts, airbags, or helmets about the facts, okay? So I want you to do either a poster or a radio ad or a video. Now, a radio ad would be like this. Let me show you. This was a radio ad from two classes ago. All you got to do is write out a script. So just take a piece of paper, think about some of the facts that you want to convey. Do it in a manner that would get people's attention, and maybe practice the script a couple times and then read it, put it on your phone and send it as a file. Here's a person that did one, two classes ago. So here's a radio ad.
Hey, listeners, this is Jake from WC Safety. Everyone lend me your ears, especially if you are between the ages of 18 to 24 and you think seatbelts just aren't cool. What is cool to you? Surviving a car crash or being thrown out your windshield and onto the street? Here's the deal. If you wear your seatbelt, you double your chances of survival. If you are injured in a car crash, wearing that uncool seatbelt will also reduce the likelihood that you have a serious injury by about half. Young listeners, focus on trying to live. And everyone else, influence the smart behavior of wearing seatbelts. Always wear your seatbelt and make the behavior common, expected, and cool.
So that was a radio ad. He did a fantastic job. I want it to be around 30 minutes. So radio ads due tomorrow, posters due tomorrow. If you do a video, because videos, you've got to set it up. You can use someone else in class. You could do it together. You can use your brother, your sister, your parents. You can use anybody, but it's going to take you a little bit of time to film it, to edit it, and send it to me. Let me show you two quick videos. Here's one of my favorites.
All right, Violet, time for school.
Can we listen to some music?
Yeah, what song?
You know what.
Da, 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 da. It's the one and only Deagle Double G.
Snoop Dogg. Snoop
Dogg. Da, 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 da. You know I'm mobbing with the D-R-E.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know the West Coast is back for all you suckers.
What? I'm burning it up. DPGC, you should be turning.
Now, wasn't that good? Didn't that get your attention? I mean, it had music. It had some humor. Definitely hanging from the tree. It took them a little bit of time to do something like that. So do a video, something like that. I won't show you. I'll show you another one tomorrow since videos aren't due until next Tuesday. So you got a whole week to work on it if you want to do it. So you do well on the video. If you do a video, I'll give you some extra credit on the final that you'll take here in Driver's Ed. But poster radio ad is just regular homework. You got to get it in. Okay, so that's due tomorrow and do your reading. So that is it. I apologize. I had a couple glitches tonight with my technology. I'm going to try to find my videos tomorrow, get them all lined up before we have class. But tomorrow, communication, vision, and turning. So that's it. Oh, 2 o'clock, 5 o'clock tomorrow. Anybody wants to drive at 2 o'clock or 5 o'clock, text me. In the next 5 minutes, I'll take a look who's... I'm going to give top priority to people that haven't driven. But if people who have driven once or twice want to take that time and nobody else wants it, I'll give it to you. 2 o'clock, 5 o'clock is what I have for tomorrow. And then we'll deal with Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and stuff like that. So that's it for tonight. Thanks for tuning in. See you tomorrow, 7:30. So be here and stay online. Don't leave. I can see some people are leaving. All right. Have a good night.